Hello, everybody. I hope you are enjoying the inspiring talks and stories. I'm going to start with a story. A story of a seven-year-old boy who was sitting on the top of a staircase. It was around midnight, and he was listening to the loud voices of his parents arguing. But this night wasn't like any other night. He heard the threat in his father's voice while he was screaming, And he ran downstairs and opened the door and saw his father trying to beat his mother. This young boy ran towards his parents and tried to pull his father off of his mother and tried to push her towards the garden, tried to give her a chance to escape the violence. He heard the approaching footsteps of his father and tried to hold his mother with his eyes closed. Then he heard a loud bang and a crack. He opened his eyes and looked up and saw his mother's nose in an angle he's never seen it before. And then warm drops of blood fell on his face. It was a memory he would never forget. After nights like these, he and his mother and sometimes his sister would move to a home for victims of domestic violence. They would stay there for a couple of nights until his mother heard that there wasn't any place for them there anymore. Other people need to stay there, so she could go nowhere. She didn't have family who could help her. So she was forced to go back home to her husband and his father. And while they grow up, events like this kept reoccurring. His energy level was high. His energy level rivaled that of a hurricane. And you can imagine that the combination of an environment like that with his energy level caused troubles in society, at school. And soon he had to find a way to handle his energy. And his parents thought of sports. So they, as many boys his age did, he went to play soccer. He did a few competitions, a few training sessions, and worked towards a competition. Now in this competition, he tried to grab the ball and run towards the goal of his opponents, and he tried to score throwing the ball in. It was very clear by then that soccer wasn't his sport. So you would think rugby or American football would be his next step. But luckily there was somebody who knew his parents and told his parents that there was a nice judo place around. And then he started to do judo. Years later, that boy is me. And as of last month, I became world medalist and belong to the best three heavyweights in the world, now going towards my second Olympic Games. As you now know, I had a challenging youth. I spent seven of my teenager years in juvenile homes and even in juvenile prisons because there wasn't enough place in those juvenile homes. Imagine an environment escaping violence, but living in an environment that is violent, with burglars, with other boys who tried to kill other people. It was a sad environment. And there were nights where he cried himself to sleep, feeling very lonely. And at a certain point, he didn't trust anyone. And at a certain point, he confided in a staff member and told the staff member something very confidential. I told the staff member something very confidential. To read it later in a report for everybody to read, even my parents could read it. And it was something I hoped wouldn't come out. And from this moment on, I decided that I wouldn't live in that shadow any longer. I would crawl out this situation and I would build a life. a good life. I didn't have anything to build on. So my mother, she sent me postcards in this period sometimes about faith, about trust, about God, and about love. Grabbing back on those cards, that gave me a lot of love and hope. I knew that religion, spirituality could help me building a life. She sent books about spirituality, varying from the Bible to the Bhagavad Gita, books about psychology and Buddhism. And I understood that if I wanted to change my reality, if I wanted to change my life, I had to understand life and I had to understand myself. I challenged the boundaries of my mind by doing things my sane mind told me not to do. As an example, in my cell, in a juvenile prison, I was fully closed and there was a shower in my cell. I went into that shower with my clothes on and my sane mind, I was like, Roy, stop doing it. You're acting very silly. Don't do it. And I still did it. I had to let go of that what I thought was the right thing to do. And at a certain point underneath that shower, I let it go so completely that even the bodily fluids I consumed earlier that day went down the drain. I opened my eyes and I looked in my room towards my closet. And I knew it was a closet, but all the associations that normally came with it, the thoughts and emotions, they weren't there. There was so much space in my mind. It was there that I saw a different reality than what I knew. Another example what happened from this point on, where I felt really reborn. I went into the yard and there was a small flower there. I have seen many flowers until the moment I was 17, but I've never really seen them before. I looked upon that flower and it was so beautiful that I started crying with a happy smile, with a happy goofy smile on my face. And another example is that in this environment there were a lot of people I didn't like and who I knew didn't like me, but I decided that I would see them as my best friends and I would love them as such. And a strange thing happened there. They started to become the beautiful people I saw in them. From this moment where I decided to change, I told the staff members, the behavior expert and the psychologist that I would be gone in 6 months. They all started laughing. 6 months later, the juvenile judge deciding over my case had a thick dossier, an almost 8-inch dossier, and he sat down and threw that dossier with a smack on his desk and with a happy smile. He told me, you know, there are only 2 or 3 boys I encounter in a year who make a 180-degree turn for the best, for the good. And I'm so happy to tell you that I will give you a chance to try again in society. I had no diplomas, and I was thinking about what can I do? Where am I good in? And then judo came up. I had no college degrees. I didn't study. And 1 year later, from that moment on, I became one of the most successful junior judo players in the world. And since 2017, I also finished my college degree. I've talked about spirituality, but I also want to talk about something else, and that's about loss. My story is a story. It starts with loss, and everybody knows loss in some way. Everybody knows what it is to lose someone or to lose in life. But my perception towards loss changed in that shower. And looking at loss make me question myself, what if loss yields the most profit? What if my perception towards loss decides the success I have in life? A lot of times when we do something we really care about, when we try to reach our dreams and goals, there is choice paralysis. There are non-authentic decisions because it's something we care about and we really don't want to lose. It holds us back. But I have learned, my experience teach me that loss can yield the most profit. And I really want to ask you, I want to ask you the question, does loss hold you back or does it make you grow? Thank you.